Hello, welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I'm Mike Zielinski. My guest today is Levi Landis, who is the Executive Director of the GoggleWorks. Welcome, Levi.
Thanks for having me, Mike.
Now, you've been on the job since when? February?
March. Yeah, March 1st. Okay. Absolutely. Yeah, don't rush it.
So let's get to the nitty-gritty. What changes have you made since you've been on board?
Oh, wow. You put me on the spot. Well, there's been some restructuring and some changes to the team that we have involved.
Yeah.
Without getting too far into it, I'll just say, it's really important to draw some of the volunteers, some of the staff closer that we're excited about the work that we're doing moving forward. In addition to that, a big part is trying to identify the artistic mission that we're doing. So often people say, GoggleWorks, I've seen that there. I don't know the work that you're doing as well, or is it community development? Are you a rec center?
Really?
Or an art center? Yeah,
really?
they just don't know how to kind of pinpoint the work that we do. So a big part of it is trying to use some language, try to hone in on what it is exactly that we want people to know us for.
Yeah. What'd you come up with?
Well, a big part of it is trying to make a place that the community feels comfortable, so that we are diversifying, we are reaching out to the Latino, the Black communities, making a place that everybody feels comfortable. That's a big part of it. But also trying to find a place where we're recruiting great talent, international, national artists to come, places where they can work for either, whether it be weeks on end, if it's an intensive or a long workshop program, or simply to be invited as a studio artist. We have many studio artists on the second and third floors as well. So, again, trying to hone in the different areas that we're working in, but also try to have a little more of an approachable artistic mission, so that everybody in the community feels like that's a place for me.
Yeah, I was actually kind of surprised to hear you say that most people didn't realize it was arts related, because that kind of surprised me. But some people just aren't paying attention, I guess.
It's that, but it's also the feeling that. I guess sometimes the feeling that arts can mean almost anything. So people feel like, oh, they have weddings there. Maybe they'd be willing to host our basketball meeting. And for the most part, we do have a wide range of ways that people can interact.
But I've been to some weddings. It's a great venue for weddings.
It's a beautiful space for it.
And the movie theater, too. That's really special.
Absolutely.
Especially the type of movies you bring in.
Absolutely. I mean, yesterday I went to the discussion group for the new movie Captain Fantastic, and what a great time to see people of all ages engaging with a movie that you can't get at the IMAX, which is across the street, and we're happy to have there. You can't get it at one of the other theaters, but it really is an art house movie. So you're right. It's got a lot of things for a lot of different groups.
And plus a very convenient parking lot, which is always an issue when you're in Center City. I read on the website or whatever when they announced your hiring, you want to bring a protean approach to the arts. And we were joking before we went on the air, you have a master's from Villanova. I only have a bachelor's from Temple. I had no idea what that word meant. But it means variable, mutable, something like that.
Yeah.
So you want to be flexible?
Well, that's it. And you mentioned Villanova, so I'll just say go Wildcats.
What a great basketball season.
Absolutely. But, yeah. but you mentioned that $10,000 word, if you will, protean. I mean,
is that how you say it? I probably mispronounced
well,
it.
Well, yeah. No, I think you did fine, John. But the point being that broadness, as I just mentioned, can be a liability, because it can mean that people don't necessarily know how to pinpoint what it is you do.
Yeah.
But broadness can also be, or breadth if you want to say, can also be a real asset, because you can if you're specific enough in your tone, you can be broad and offer a lot of things for a lot of people. And there are so many expectations from our artists that are housed in GoggleWorks, to the people coming to the film theater, to people that are coming to exhibitions and programs, students that are taking classes. So that's a lot of expectations. And we want to be able to be broad and still be very vital and have a, I hate this word, but have a brand that people can say, oh, I know that's GoggleWorks. I can tell by the look of it or the feel if you will.
Well, hey, everybody wants a brand these days.
Sure.
There's companies and advertising agencies just specialize that alone.
Absolutely.
So specifically, with doing that approach, can you point to a couple examples since you've taken over? I realize you're only a few months into this.
Yeah. No, that's a very fair point. You know, some of it is my predecessors did a great job of putting in programs like intensives, summer intensives. For instance, we just started a 12-week course where students from all over the country can work with our resident woodshop artist, Craig Stevens, who is an expert in marquetry, inlay, cabinet making. So over the course of 12 weeks, they'll be building a cabinet that is among the finest you'll see in the world. I mean, it's amazing. Amazing work. But then you can also see our summer camps, which just ended, where there'll be students from all over the area that come, some on scholarship and it's subsidized, others who have the money, they're able to afford the summer camps. And so you'll see kids from some of the most underserved areas in Reading that are able to come engage with the arts or take a class. Mm-hmm. And so that's really what we mean, is that it's not a place where you just go, oh, that's for those people. It really is for you. And so GoggleWorks is a place for anyone who's hearing this or watching this. They can go, that's a place for me. And I can guarantee that if they look at our calendar of events, they'll find something like that.
Yeah, it's interesting because you're basically almost have like a twofold approach, because in a way you are diverse, but you also want to have more specific orientation, which is somewhat of a challenge, but I understand why you need to do that.
Absolutely.
Also, I think when you first got the position, you said you just want to expand upon the vision of the founders and the board of directors.
Yes.
Can you cite any examples there? Or?
Well, you know, what really drew me in, and I come most recently from the museum world in Philadelphia, where I worked at the Center for Art and Wood.
Yeah, your reference to wood a couple of minutes ago kind of, because I realized you're really into that.
Absolutely.
You know? And you were the, what, fund development director there?
I was the director of business operations, which involved fund development, involved taking care of operations, managing the staff.
Yeah.
But, you know, my point being that there you could say the mission is so narrow in that it involves one medium, wood, and it involves a pretty narrow group of enthusiasts and people that want to come to see a museum setting. They want to look at the collection.
I was surprised.
They want to engage with the work.
When I read your background, because I didn't realize, I never heard of it, because I thought that, boy, that is really narrow.
It is narrow. Before that, I was at the Philadelphia Folk Song Society, which presents the Philadelphia Folk Festival. There it's very broad in that the Folk Festival.
Yeah, I know. And
it can be 50,000 people over one weekend. So, you know, I've had an interesting history in that I've had to work with both very accessible, very broad programs, and then very niche and narrow. And I think one thing that really struck me about GoggleWorks is here you have people that are willing to put their money on the line, put a vision out there. They have a very clear vision about how the city can help develop. But it's also, as I said, a place that almost anybody can come. So I realized that very early on that it was a sort of field of dreams approach, if you will. If we build it, they will come. And that can have its drawbacks, because sometimes, you know, early on they won't come, or if they do, it requires a lot of work to follow up to build that audience over time. So
And then also some advertising dollars. Now, in the era of social media, it's become easier.
Sure.
But I remember when the GoggleWorks first opened, you know, that was a challenge. I don't know. The Reading Eagle was very supportive for a while, giving them basically free ads just to get the word out. You know?
Sure, they've been a great supporter. I mean, I could list a whole host of people, but you know, I should thank Paul Cohn, who leads our board, who has some tremendous supporters from, you know, Marlon Miller, Albert Boskoff, and Irv Cohn, who are our three founders and our primary donors, to a whole host of other people that give us in-kind services and cash donations. I mean, they're really the lifeblood of how we can continue to do things, in addition to a whole host of volunteers that help us implement, because our staff is so small. I call them our baseball team, because it's 9 full-time staff, even though we have hundreds of teachers and others.
Yeah.
But it really is a small staff that I say, go, and they rush to
get
everything
in place.
Welcome
to the world of nonprofits.
Yeah, exactly.
You would seem to be the ideal person to have your job, because you have a passion for the arts, you have a diversity in your background in arts, and again, the fundraising, the business development, because I know the business model for the GoggleWorks is a challenge. What happens in the post, you know, you've cited Marlon Miller, Albert Boskoff, and who was the other gentleman?
Irv Cohn.
Irv
Lewis.
What happens the post them? You know, well, that's why you're here, to get more money? Or
I think that's a big part of it. You know, I don't want to. It was made very clear to me from the board when they were searching, and it's made clear to everybody who leads an organization like this. You have to make things sustainable. They want to see the organization be sustainable, not only from the programs that we offer. So. We've been around just over 10 years, right? And I think early on, the question was, can we offer enough classes that will net X number of dollars and that will be the Occam's razor? We've since realized there's no Occam's razor. There's sort of a variety of solutions that have to be met to make it sustainable. There's almost no art center in the country, none that I can think of, that can simply say, our programs offer enough earned revenue to help us keep going. It's a mix of donor dollars, earned revenue, special events, galas, fundraisers. I mean, it's really a mix of that. So we're lucky to have a strong, like I said, volunteer development team with folks like Cindy Boskoff, Tom McMahon, the former mayor, volunteers that give time and time again to make sure that our events and our programs are strong in the community, in addition to trying to make the programs really sustainable.
Are there national grants and community foundations, things like that? Are they other additional revenue streams?
Yes, and we're seeking those now. I've got a unique relationship with some national organizations. What I've found is, and it's so impressive in Berks County, I was so impressed in the fact that local foundations, local donors, you'll see the same names pop up again
and
again.
It's amazing. It really is.
And they support a whole host of things in this area. But it also made me aware that we have to step outside of that as well. Those people can't be expected to continue to you know, you said, what do you do after the founders, post-founders? I mean,
there's legacy things, but still.
Absolutely. But those are questions that I think everybody has to ask themselves, to say, you know, are these people going to be able to give again and again to every new program that comes out or every new organization?
Yeah.
And the answer is no. So by working with the state on state grants and the NEA, NEH, the Wingate Foundation, I mean, these are broad-level organizations nationwide that are giving to fine arts, fine crafts, large art centers, and things that make the arts accessible to everybody in the community.
How unique is the GoggleWorks nationwide? Because it's a treasure for Berks County to have it. Is it common in other areas, or is the size and scope of this a little unique?
That's a great question, because that really is what makes GoggleWorks unique, is that not just the size, it's 145,000 square feet, six buildings, a whole campus that used to be the Wilson Goggle Factory.
I remember all the broken windows.
I'm telling you, you probably know.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a building that has such a rich history, so that in and of itself is so unique to see a space revamped like that. There's maybe a handful, a dozen if you really push, that are doing that kind of work.
Yeah.
None at this size. It is the largest center of its size in the country.
Now, is that include, because I know GoggleWorks too, and I want to ask you about that.
Sure.
A little bit more specifically in a minute. Does that space that you're talking about include that?
The space, the square footage does include that.
Okay.
But even if you took that away, it's the largest.
Okay.
There's two or three that are similar, and most of that is rental space, so their mission's a little bit different. But one thing I wanted to point out in terms of the uniqueness is, nowhere will you find such a broadness, especially in terms of the studio space. There is a hot glass studio that's unlike any other in the country, led by Scott Kreninsky, who does a great job.
I actually seen some of this stuff.
His work is phenomenal. James Pastor, who just took over as the programs director, was leading the clay studio, so there's a clay shop in there. As I mentioned, Craig's doing things in the wood shop. So to have clay, hot glass, wood, fused glass, I mean, to have that broadness of programs, not just with teaching, but hands-on workshops, demonstrations, it's completely unique. And so that was one thing that drew me to this position and really excited me.
Now tell us a little bit about the GoggleWorks too, because I understand it should be opening soon, and maybe you alluded a little bit to some of the differences in GoggleWorks too, but if you could expound on that.
Absolutely. I mean, that's a project that our city, Reading, which is a great partner of ours, started by Albert Boskoff. They're working on very, very strongly to get a live-in space for artists. We have about 35 artist studios on the second and third floor of GoggleWorks, which is the main building, Building 1. Building 2 is across an air bridge connected to GoggleWorks, but would would be about 25, 27 spaces where artists can live in their studios, work in those spaces, and also have it open to the public to come and enjoy. So that would create two things. Number one, it would create a stronger community of artists living there, really right. nationally curated. So Albert and others are looking to universities like UArts, you went to Temple, mm-hmm. other places in Philadelphia and New York to be able to get national level artists into those spaces. So we create a stronger community, but also create a really, what I would call a creative economy in that area. So those are people that are going to be eating dinner and lunch in that area.
Well, that's exactly what we need. Different type of people move in the city, yep, you know?
Absolutely. And you mentioned the parking lot, and I kind of took a two-level approach to even the layout, whereas you can drive in for people that are comfortable driving, whether they're outside of the area or right. coming from across the bridge in West Reading or Wyomissing, but you can also walk up. And so the frontage really has to be worked on to say, how does this engage the community immediately to the north as well? To say, you can pull in, stop, park your car and come in if that's your preference. Or you can walk up and go to a restaurant across the street as they're working on building some of the restaurants over there.
Yeah, there's a new restaurant that's supposedly coming in. I think it's the guy, he's had some local Mexican restaurants. And I guess there's going to be a rum bar, too. And it's so nice to have a companion restaurant to Panavino's. I know Albert Bosco has wanted to do that for years, and it's been a challenge.
Yeah, I can tell you that they're looking cultural. You know, Cuban is what I'm hearing, which would be great because we have a Cuban artist, Julio Cepeda, who's coming in 2018. Beautiful work. We're doing a film festival now, which for the next two weekends we'll have Cuban films preparing and raising funds for that. So that's a great opportunity to bring in a little bit of the culture from the Latino community. It's very broad. There's Puerto Ricans, there's Cubans, mm-hmm. there's Mexicans. And so this is a great opportunity to say, wow, what does this relationship look like for people that are able to now travel to and from Cuba? Can we bring an artist up to do some installations, do an exhibition?
And Tom McMahon has some connections in Cuba.
Absolutely.
Tom's been on the show, and he shared his trip to Cuba. You know, I referenced the fact that it's important for a community to have artists moving in to add to the populace. Broaden that a little bit, why are arts so important to community? And they are very important to community, especially downtown.
To be as blunt as I can, strong communities deserve strong arts. You won't find a strong community in this country or elsewhere that doesn't have either strong institutional arts or artists working at the ground level, grassroots level, to build the arts. It's a sign of a community's expression. That can be anything from culinary, you know, food, music, things that tend to be more accessible, or it can be very niche. It can be folk art, painting. So it can take on a broad array of forms, but that in and of itself shows the expressive nature of a community. So when you see a community that's building, or it's more diverse, or it's vibrant, it really will have an art scene there. Now, whether it's exposed to the public and whether it's apparent is another question. That's what GoggleWorks wants to be. We want to be the creative consciousness in Berks County so that people say, I heard they're doing something where they're trying to get artists involved. Mm-hmm. How do I see that? Look at GoggleWorks and you'll see how that happens. And that's why we have to be broad, and we sometimes have to take on a lot of projects at once. And, you know, quite frankly, and I'll admit this, we miss the mark every once in a while. We have challenges that are very difficult. We have financial challenges. We have ways that we don't always engage the community in the ways mm-hmm. we want. And so we want to live up to those as well, to say, that's a big task. It's a large burden. You know, the other thing I'd love to mention is that our enemy is really apathy. You know, other organizations, they're fighting crime, or they're fighting cancer, or they're fighting something that is a little more, you can pinpoint it. At GoggleWorks or in arts organizations, we're really fighting this feeling of, oh, you know what, let's let it go. Let's stay in tonight. Let's watch TV, or you know, let's make a microwave dinner. You know, we're there to challenge people to say, try something new. Come see, you know, an art film. Come try a class. Make something. If you make something, you get to walk away with an object, and you get to walk away with the experience.
You know, it's interesting because, you know, like, people indirectly may not understand the tangible benefit of the arts, but in the visual arts, or even, you know, music. There is a very vivid, tangible benefit.
Absolutely.
You can see it or you can hear it.
Absolutely. Enough can't be said about the actual material and the product that's created. We live in a commodity-based culture where, you know, you can go to a store and buy a mop you're going to throw away later. But if something's handmade and you can see it, my goodness, people respond to that. So, yeah. I mean, we're in this age where you reclaim something or you find found art or junk and you create something out of it. People's eyes light up because they're just not... there's not the same tangibility as there was. And so when you connect people with that, it's terribly rewarding, and it's cost me my career, my life, you know. It's been a whole lifelong passion now to connect people with that tangible thing you were speaking of.
Yeah, and you know, and pardon me as I glance at my notes.
No, please.
But you've also been very involved with floating festivals, which I kind of liked. It's dedicated to producing high-quality festivals and cultural programs that celebrate engaged communities.
Sure.
So that's a philosophy you're bringing to the GoggleWorks?
Absolutely.
And are you going to do anything outside of the GoggleWorks in the community in conjunction with that? Or is GoggleWorks all you need to do?
It's pretty much all I need. It's got all the makings of that.
Yeah.
I still continue to run that organization. It started while I was at the Philadelphia Folk Festival, and I was realizing that I could bring that festival model to cities, neighborhoods, blocks. And so we started the Second Street Music Festival, which is still running today. It gets about 10 to 15,000 people over the course of a weekend in Philadelphia. But you'll see these festivals popping up where, and there's some right here in Reading, you know, Dave Klein from the Reading just started the Country Festival.
And of course, there's the Brooks Jazz Fest.
Absolutely. Yeah. John does a great job. Yeah. And Karen Haver, who's one of our arts partners there at the GoggleWorks. So these are people that are finding there's a niche, there's something unique about Berks County or the community. How can we exploit that? And so I'm going to be bringing that. You're going to see a lot more festival model things.
Oh, happening. That's great. Because, yeah. You know, because the thing is, I think Berks County has been blessed over the years. You know, obviously the GoggleWorks is a fantastic addition. But for a small town, I mean, we have a symphony orchestra. We have the Pops.
Absolutely.
We have the Reading Museum. You know, we've talked about the festivals. You know, besides the music festival, there's the Quitstown Folk Festival and some of the other stuff.
And I'd be remiss not to mention the Arts Festival Reading, which is our prime festival in GoggleWorks, happening in a couple weeks, the first weekend of October.
That's right. I know October is always a big month for you
and
guys.
Penny Golden, Jenny Han, they've launched, I mean, there's 29 committees now. So in addition to all the volunteers.
Sometimes you can have too many committees.
I know, right? But no, they do a wonderful job. All volunteer festival produced. You'll see dozens of artists. It takes over GoggleWorks. So it's amazing to see people pushing to every corner of the building. It's really operating at the top of our game and our mission.
Now, I know you still live in Philadelphia, right?
Just moved here last week. We moved to 5th and Douglas in Center Park.
Okay. So. Oh, that's a nice area.
Yeah, we love it.
Because my question is, I mean, how much did you know about Reading before you took the job?
Crash course. Yeah. Absolutely a crash course. You know, I came up to visit when I was interested in the job. Had been here. I used to, in a former life, was a musician, so I'd played some music.
Yeah, you've been a recording artist?
That's right.
You've cut a record?
Yeah, absolutely.
Are you a vocalist or do you play instruments?
Vocalist. I play guitar, mandolin, mostly strings, but some percussion instruments as well.
And you're not doing that anymore because you don't have time?
I don't have time, and I also realize there's so many artists out there that I have to support that I, you know... You know, there's not always the time to be doing it, for your own work.
You're the typical Renaissance man. I mean, the one other thing I want to mention, we only have a couple more minutes.
Sure.
You also have served on the Board of Rock to the Future,
yep.
Which provides music education to thousands of students in Philadelphia's underserved neighborhood. Now, that's an awesome endeavor.
I try to keep involved in the music. As I said, I can't get out and play as much as I'd hope to, but there's an organization where they're providing, I mean, they're starting up a makeshift recording studio where kids can come in and play in a recording studio and get the feel of what it's like to cut their own record, serve as a producer.
Oh, yeah.
But in addition to that, they're doing classes and programs for students to get to learn guitars, drums. So these are kids that have I'm always impressed by Berks County because as depressed and as much financial difficulty as there is, there's still music in the schools. There's still arts in the schools.
Right.
Philadelphia, almost every music program has been cut.
Oh, really? Oh, that's
so an organization like that, the only way they'll get music in the schools is through Rock to the Future or the Philadelphia Folk Song Society or some nonprofit that says, I'm going to keep giving arts.
Yeah, maybe it's because of the aforementioned things we've talked about with the different music and the festivals, but there is a passion for that. I know the Berks Arts Council really is into music education tied in with the Jazz Fest.
Not only them, but another great partner at the GoggleWorks is the Reading Musical Foundation.
They've been around forever. No question about that.
Absolutely.
Well, because of them, and I partnered with the Downtown Improvement District, I happen to be their chairman.
Oh, great.
We have those pianos right outside. You know, and I'm downtown, and I see people actually sitting down at the piano all the time.
Absolutely. I just twiddle around on the one at the Doubletree. It's beautiful.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's great.
Yeah, it is kind of cool. And
yeah,
I know they decorate and stuff like that.
Thanks for bringing it. That's great.
We only have like a minute left. So how do you want to sum up? Well, first of all, congratulations. It sounds like
you're doing
a great job and you have a monumental job ahead of you. But so far, so good, you think?
Absolutely. I mean, if I was to do anything, I'd play salesman for a second and just say, go to goggleworks.org.
Sure.
I mean, we have the Arts Festival Reading coming up. We have a great conference coming in from out of town. Been in Allentown for the last few years, but it's the IX. It's a fantasy art conference coming the third week in October.
Awesome.
So October is going to be packed. We have Pumpkin Palooza, which is another event where you can come.
That sounds like fun.
Get a glass pumpkin. So there's a lot of things in October, but we're always looking for new volunteers, supporters, or just someone to come engage with the arts.
All right. Levi, thank you
Thanks so much, Mike.
Levi Landis, Executive Director of the GoggleWorks. And keep up the great work. And for now, this is Mike Zielinski saying goodbye.
Oktoberfest is BCTV's largest annual fundraiser.